In this talk, I'm going to describe very briefly how smartphones, how a smartphone application can be used to learn physics by doing experiments. We know, I'm going to divide the talk in three parts. First, I will describe some applications, two applications only, we have developed. Then I will show how those applications can be used in laboratory experiments or in experiments outside the laboratory in everyday activities. And finally, I'm going to give some brief results of a preliminary work with students, with high school students. Well, we all know that the use of mobile devices, smartphones and tablets, has increased enormously around the last years. In many areas, smartphones are used as knowledge facilitators. In other areas, they are used to follow and assess the students' advances and difficulties, or even to increase the communications between the students or between the students and the teachers. However, we as physics teachers and the students, as physics students, are very lucky because smartphones are plenty of sensors that we can also use as experimental tools to do measurements either in the laboratory or in everyday activities, where the students by themselves can learn just by observing nature and by confronting their own measurements, their own results with their knowledge or beliefs. In this sense, I would like to show you two recent papers. This from the American Physical Society, in which we can see that using mobile devices as experimental tools here could foster conceptual learning. And another, this is from July, this paper, and the next one is even more recent because it's a contribution to a paper in a conference one month ago in Munich. We can see that in this contribution, the authors talk about the increase of the positive effect of using smartphones due to the connection between the everyday device that is linked to the lives of the students to an everyday activity. Well, so considering this, taking this into account, what is our work? Well, currently we are working along three complementary lines that you can see there in the slide. We develop mobile applications to learn physics. Including these mobile applications, include theory, samples, tests, simulations, different tools. We also develop mobile applications to use the smartphone or the tablets, mobile devices in general, as experimental tools. And the third line is thinking how these devices can be used, and this application can be used redefining classical experiments so that the students can do all those experiments in a different fashion, a different way, by using the smartphones. Well, in this talk I'm going to describe only, mostly, the second point, two examples of the second point. I have more applications developed by our group in my smartphone, so if anyone is interested, we can see them later. And I'm going to show two examples also of using those applications in experiments. Well, the first application I want to mention to you is Sensor Mobile. Sensor Mobile allows the students and everyone to access all the sensors in a smartphone, accelerometer, gyroscope, magnetometer, light sensor, sound sensor, whatever, barometer, including the GPS also. Allow everyone to access all those sensors to save data, export data, and retrieve data, doing figures, and okay, here we can see some screenshots. You can see, for example, these screenshots here of the magnetometer when the application is using and displaying the magnetometer results, the light sensor, for example, and and a case study of using the GPS in a field experiment, so that in this case, for example, is an experiment I will describe later, the students can correlate their results using different sensors with their location, just in case it may be interesting. Okay, this is the first application I was going to talk about. And the second is audio. This second application accesses only one sensor of the smartphone, only the sound sensor, that is the microphone. But it has a different development philosophy underneath it, because not only access the microphone, and allows the students to do measurements, but it also includes explanations on different effects and phenomena, for example, stationary waves, Doppler effect, beats, interferences, and allows the students or the teacher use it as, for example, a sonometer to analyze frequencies by doing fast Fourier transform, or to generate sound waves. And another interesting point is that this application also allows the smartphone to be calibrated so that the measurements performed with different smartphones and different sensors can be compared. Well, in this next slide, I will show you three screenshots of this, of using this application, just as a sonometer here, just here displaying, recording the sound intensity and displaying the intensity of the sound, and in this one, the result of fast Fourier transform performed by the smartphone with this application, so that the students can do an analysis of frequencies of different sounds that they record. And here, as you can see here, the students can change here the units, save, pause, many options, of course. Well, let's go with the examples about how this applications can be used in the laboratory or outside the laboratory. This first experiment is a more traditional experiment, more or less in the laboratory, can be done in the laboratory. It consists of measuring the frequencies of vibration or the overtones of rods. Here you can see of different materials, lengths, of course, different materials. We use a steel and aluminium, and different sections. We use a rectangular section and circular section rods. And this expression here are not as complicated as mechanical fluids expressions, but this expression here allows the student to calculate the frequencies taking into account the material by the Young modulus, or the shape of the rod by this parameter K. And in the next slide, I will show you some results using this application. In the upper figure here, you can see the fast Fourier transform performed by the smartphone That is, we use the smartphone by going backwards. We use the smartphone recording the sound of the vibrating rod, and then, with the same application audio, we perform the fast Fourier transform, and by this fast Fourier transform, we can detect the frequencies of the vibration of the rod. And in this table here, I don't know if you there can see the numbers or not. Okay, it doesn't matter. The agreement is surprisingly good. And there is a comparison between the experiment, the experimental results, and the theoretical calculations obtained by the expressions shown before. And in spite of just such a simple experiment, using a smartphone, using a mobile application, we can see the accuracy of the results and the good agreement with the theoretical calculations. And this figure below just shows the comparison for different rods, for different number of overtones, and you can't see the discrepancies, you can't see the differences between theory with dots, full dots, and experiment with crosses, because they fold the crosses, just the experimental results, over, just more or less exactly over the theoretical calculations. Just to have an idea of how what accuracy we can obtain by using the smartphone. The next experiment is a different case. In this experiment, we wanted the students to use everyday activities to learn physics. That is, we wanted the students to realize that they could learn physics just by observing nature that surrounds them. And in this case, this experiment consisted on travel from home to the faculty in biology, the smartphone with the application sensor mobile that I described before was placed in the window car, or in the car window, sorry. So that the x-axis was transversal to the direction of the movement, the y-axis was vertical, and the z-axis, see that the axis pointed along the direction of the movement. Well, I'm going to show you only three results in three slides. And the first one I wanted to show you was I choose this to be a little complicated, maybe, because I wanted you to see how by cross-analyzing results from different sensors. For example, here we have in red the accelerometer in the transversal direction. I'm going back for you to remind the direction of the axis, x-axis, transversal, y, vertical, sit up in the direction of the movement. Well, the accelerometer in the transversal direction, the accelerometer result in the direction of the movement, the gyroscope in the vertical direction, and the instantaneous velocity, the speed of the movement obtained from the GPS data. What can the students learn by crossing results from different sensors? For example, in this region where the acceleration along the direction of the movement is nearly null, here in green, the speed of the car remains more or less constant. While when the acceleration along the direction of the movement, green, changes in one sense, or in the opposite sense, here in green, you can see how the speed, or the students can see how the speed increases or decreases, and then remains more or less constant when the acceleration disappears. Another thing that the students can learn by crossing information from different sensors is that when the car turns,
And then the gyroscope detects that curve here. Then appears an acceleration here in red in the direction transversal to the movement, that is what we call the centripetal acceleration. But, okay, this is more or less qualitative analysis by crossing different results of different sets of results. If we want the students to do a more quantitative analysis, we should go to simpler results or simpler comparison between sensor data. For example, here we are only comparing the speed, the instantaneous speed here, and the distance, the traveling distance. And you can see, or the students can see, how when the speed decreases and it's nearly null, the distance travels to remain more or less constant. And however, when the speed increases, and we have plotted here an average value of the speed in this interval of, take into account, we are talking about 40 seconds. In this interval of 40 seconds, the travel distance increases, as should be expected, with a linear trend whose slope is the average value of the speed in this range of time. And the final slide I want to show you here is how the students can also use GPA's data to compare or to analyze the results. For example, here is the speed in this travel from home to the faculty, how the speed changes depending on the location of the car. But also they can use this to analyze magnetic fields or whatever, sound, to make noise measurements or noise maps or whatever. Well, these are two examples, but I want to finish the talk, or the third part of the talk is another interesting point is the result, and I'm going to talk here about the results of an experiment, of a teaching experiment with high school students with 16 and 17 years old. And we took several high school students and we described them how and their professors, and we described them how they could use mobile applications to make these experiments. That was the first part of the experiment, just talking about the use of mobile applications. And we invited them to install those applications in their own smartphones, to try to use them, whatever they wanted, just by downloading from the free application stores, and to analyze them and to choose one of them, whatever they wanted. And then we took them to our laboratory and we helped them and taught them to use those applications to do quantitative measurements in the laboratory along simple experiments, simple physics experiments, for example, linear movement, circular movement, pendulum, collisions. And once they have learned, or a full afternoon or so, we sent them home. And we invited them to try to use those applications to learn physics, to experiment by themselves along everyday activities. So you can see we are some kind of perverted teacher, that we want our students to continue thinking on our subject when they are at home. And I want to show you here some results that we obtained from the students. Some students decided to go to the merry-go-round and they used the smartphone application to measure the centripetal acceleration, and from the measurement to the distance from the smartphone to the axis, to the rotation axis, they obtained the rotation speed, the rotational speed, and they contrasted it with a more traditional measurement of another fellow that was at the rest, counting terms and measuring the time.
A second homemade experiment consisted of measuring friction coefficients between different materials by measuring the acceleration, the falling movement and the acceleration, and considering the gravity, the non-gravity acceleration. Other students, while ice skating, decided to use the smartphone to measure accelerations, speed, travel distance, and also the friction coefficient between ice and steel, and they obtained a really good result. And the final example I'm going to show you here is another student. Okay, she was also a music student, and they decided to analyze the frequencies, the resonant frequencies of tubes of different lengths, and from the results obtain the velocity of the sound in the air. And okay, I suppose you can see the results, but they are very good results. So once again, we can see that the smartphone have enough accuracy, and what is important to see from these results is that the use of smartphones increase the interest of students on physics, on doing physics by themselves. As I said at the beginning, the use of smartphones raised the interest of the students, fostered their autonomous work, that was something that also interested us, and also is it the understanding of physical concepts. Also, from results from our students at the university in a much more traditional or formal environment, learning environment, we have also seen that the use of smartphones and mobile applications increases the engagement of students with the subject, and also reduce dropouts. From these two results, the results in an informal environment, learning environment, and in a formal learning environment, we believe that smartphones and mobile applications can be a useful tool to design learning activities or learning techniques in which the students took a much more active role. There is something that I have marked here in red, because I think that this is very important, is that in order to have quantitative measurements of the influence of smartphones and mobile applications on learning and on engagement, we need real true learning analytics, much more data from students from different locations, different levels. Okay, this has not been performed yet. We have done some preliminary calculations, but this is a land that we are beginning to set our feet on. And we invite all of you to explore it with us. So every physics teacher who wants to use this application or other application, we will be happy to exchange results on learning outcomes and engagement outcomes. Thank you very much for it.